Welcome back, everyone. You're getting a look at the fans in New York. They've gathered at Playwrights Pub and are cheering on the teams in this action-packed semifinal. I bet you most of them are wishing for a Cloud9 win here just to keep the series going, if anything, because I bet...
Happy hours longer.
Exactly. Keep the drinks flowing. Anyway, we're going to jump into round three between Cloud9 and Team Liquid in just a minute, but first, we're going to click over to Twitter and see what you've been saying. To remind you, earlier in the day, we wanted to know who is the most clutch player in the North American semifinals and why. Our first one comes from at AlexD1891, and he writes, Bjergsen by far, he has constantly shown jukes and solo kills even when he is alone and near death, taking the lead. And at Npronga says, Cloud9's Meteos always pulls out the plays when the stakes get high.
Yeah, and I think I want to see a lot from Meteos here. You were talking about it a whole bunch. Yeah, really playing for Meteos. Want to see it here. Pretty damn high stakes. Got a 3-0 from this one. See what happens.
And the last two times that he played against Liquid during the regular season, he played Vi.
Yeah.
And had a 10-2 score. So he can carry and crush them in the early game. We've seen it before. See if he steps up again.
All right, will he come through this game? Our final tweet comes from at 88 Ostrich Farm, who says, Piglet is definitely the most clutch player. He pulled through putting up big numbers for great wins when it mattered most. And I don't think anyone could disagree with that.
And that's what being clutch is all about. When it matters most, you pull out the wins.
Yep, absolutely. Well, thank you to everyone who wrote in. Or if you're looking to share your thoughts, tweet us at LullySports and use the hashtag LCS. But now let's get into the round three between Cloud9 and Team Liquid. First up, Team Liquid has so many threats.
Yeah.
Cloud9, I don't know how they necessarily deal with them, because we've talked about, oh, okay, there's all this farm funneled onto Piglet in game one. Well, game two, Phoenix comes flying out the gate, quadra kill, triple kill, all these things on Azir, and then we've seen the Quas outplays in the top lane. How do you attack this as Cloud9?
I mean, you have to think about the lane matchups. You were telling me off camera that Azir is really only great against like Lissandra. Maybe we'll see other matchups come out well, but you're saying like that's the really big one there. I mean, he's still pulling Vlad on Urgot bans. Maybe you have to shuffle these around and figure out what really high impact damage you do want to give Phoenix. Clearly, in certain matchups, he can crush this game around. Quas is being ignored, right? He can have some good lane matchups, whatever, but he's not really carrying these games. But you got to figure out like who you're actually going to pin down from Cloud9, because right now, gank pressure isn't working, and even though they had a lead in the duo lane, they're not following up on it.
So it seems like it's time now for Cloud9 to abandon some of these, the stubbornness in their bans here. Yeah. Right? We've got that Vladimir, the Urgot, and the Lulu. Okay, yeah, I mean, they do great with those champions. But if anything, I think you need to switch it up now and say, all right, well, if we leave everything up, now what are you going to do, Team Liquid?
Yeah, I think they had to throw a lot of their prep out the window. And the Lulu, Vlad, I want to see those bans dropped, especially since it's going to be Team Liquid on red side, so they'll get the counter pick no matter what. So just let Phoenix pick whatever he wants. Just leave ban the Urgot still. I think that's an extremely powerful champion in the mid lane that he can pull a lot of pressure with. But leave the Lulu up. First pick it for yourself so that you don't have to deal with that from Quas. Even if you want to throw it down to support, that's fine. But just free up those bans, use them on other things that you think are going to be more threatening, and also allow yourself to dominate the early game if you get some of their late game champions off.
I mean, I've been in this exact scenario too, where you're down 0-2 against Team Liquid, and they're probably telling themselves now, how are we going to win this game? And what it usually comes to for players is, what's my best champion? How am I going to carry the hardest? Who's going to win us the game? And right now, I think that's Meteos, you know? They played the same way both times, where it's like balls is on a tank. They've been doing that all season with balls on a tank, so they should probably just keep that way. Put Meteos on something he can pressure with, and then really shove in the mid and bottom side, because they're just playing really aggressive over there, and that's basically their chance to win. Get Meteos in that like carry champion to really take control of the early game.
Back to what you know, back to what you're comfortable with. Well, as we send it over to the casters for the play-by-play, Cloud9 have had a rough start to the series, and Xpecial says one player on Cloud9 will be looking to is Sneaky.
Last year, I would say Cloud9's strengths were teamfighting and shot calling, but this split, it's pretty much Sneaky. Can Sneaky carry his team hard enough, or are they just too heavy? And I think this split is really showing Cloud9's big weaknesses. Once you take away their shot calling, decision making, and team fighting, it's just their reliance on Sneaky. And if we can shut him down, we can beat him in lane. If we can just make sure he's not huge, we can definitely beat Cloud9.
So shutting down the Sneaky guy, I guess picking away Lucian has been pretty good at doing that as well, since that's where he carries so hard.
I mean, Xpecial really hit the nail on the head right there. Cloud9 have been using Sneaky as almost their only damage source.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's their crutch in some of these games. That's what happens when you run those CC-heavy compositions with Sneaky as a damage dealer. It can work, but they have to be able to snowball those, and they cannot afford giving up early dragons and early kills in laning.
And that's a very specific thing. When Sneaky is carrying the game, he's in every lane immediately. We saw it at Worlds going through those playoffs, those quarterfinals. We'll see if he can get it going here. Teams approaching champion selects very differently. We see Zed, one of High's best players, being left up on one side, while Cloud9 saying, we need to ban those top champions for Team Liquid. Maybe Darshan's right, Zion's right, and they need to go for their comfort and not worry about Team Liquid, just play better.
Yeah, if you're talking about everybody just play your best champion, then that's what High goes to.
Yeah, yeah. You have to. He's had it open.
Shurima finds himself in the ban phase.
Yeah, after that game, that's a pretty good ban. But you also have to recognize that Cloud9, while Azir wasn't played in the first one, well, they're reacting and have to these bans now.
They threw three bans at Phoenix. He has played, not only has he played the best that he's ever played this year in the playoff games, all five playoff games, he played a different champion.
Yeah.
Five different games, five different wins, five different champions. Let's see what he pulls out.
Rising from
around
the ashes.
Balls, yeah, though.
If there were any.
Balls back on the Hecarim this time. This is not a pure tank right here. This is a champion that can carry the game. This is a champion that can snowball for you. This is a champion that can affect the bottom lane. This is a good start for Cloud9. What are you doing? Okay, so
it's the Lulu ban.
I would definitely not leave up the Lulu because
too late.
This is the Team Liquid. Yes, they have a lot of strategies. This is the one that they hold closest to their hearts. This is the one that they put so much practice into. The comps where you buff up an AD carry, and they have Piglet now. They've got this. Is
arguably Team Liquid's best team comp.
Exactly. This
is with early pick Lulu Liquid and the Janna to peel.
Piglet's like, you know what? Whatever AD carry. Don't even.
How important is an Urgot ban or Vladimir ban when you were giving Team Liquid Lulu?
So
it's what Quas feels best on. It's what Piglet feels best on. It's what Team Liquid feels best on.
They're bleeding out of their legs, so they chopped off their own head here. And it's just gushing out the top now.
Graphic.
But a flesh wound.
The floodgates have opened. That's better.
Maybe they're picking Headless Hecarim and it'll be okay.
There you go. All right. Well, they do have the potential, though, for carrying from multiple positions. The Hecarim, you mentioned, is going to be a big part. Obviously, they're going to continue on with a buff the
Kog'Maw Corki
comp right now.
Corki will be their mid laner, but they'll counterpick it.
This is one of the scariest comps to go into in this meta right now, though. And Team Liquid are one of the teams that have put in a lot of time practicing it.
Yep. It is the perfect team comp. None of this is being blocked.
They want Bard
right now.
This exact team comp, if they lock in Corki, was played in game two against CLG. Everything they're locking in right now. And Piglet went 10-1-8 in this game on that Kog'Maw.
Yeah, and they get to counterpick whatever High decides to go in in the mid lane with a twist, since Phoenix plays so many things, as to what would fit best in this team comp.
Oh my gosh.
Corki was a great pick for Team Liquid last time right there. Cloud9, they got to make up their mind here. Do they do another hard CC? I feel like if they do something like Nautilus Corki, that's their best chance at blowing up the ball of death that Team Liquid is putting together. And that's what they'll end up
There's
doing.
There's the Corki. They take it.
So, yes, Team Liquid giving them a Juggernaut or buffed AD carry or death ball or whatever you want to call this is scary. Cloud9, though. Again, they can go with the double Trinity Force. They had this combo in game one. They didn't use it correctly. They can go double Trinity Force. They can force an engage with a Nautilus Sejuani. They have the ability to try and head off this team before it gets out of control. Maybe Cloud9 can have a stronger early game, can snowball this.
Yeah, there's obviously ways to beat this Juggernaut.
It's not an unbeatable set of champions.
I really feel like Team Liquid was hoping to get Corki there.
Lulu mid. Is that where that will go?
That would be an interesting wrinkle and would really lower their damage overall. Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
Also, it would give Team Liquid a point man to absorb the Sejuani ultimate.
I think they just had to call an audible on their own strategy here with what happened in those last few picks of Cloud9, and that may have thrown Team Liquid off. This could be a very flip side game here. If Cloud9 wins, that's huge momentum for them, and Liquid loses on one of their best compositions.
Speaking of sources of damage, very, very, very few here. It's all about the Kog'Maw. So, well, Lulu,
what was
Lulu,
the best composition?
Lulu, yes, is going to add a decent amount, you know, in the mid game. And buff up the Kog'Maw, but yeah. Cloud9, if they can, you know, punish some mispositioning.
Single point of failure now for Team Liquid. They no longer have... They also really lower their poke damage with the Psy on top overall. It definitely makes them a harder tank ball to cut through. I mean, Sion is hard to kill in the first place. You add the fact that they can jugger Sion on top of that, or however you want to call it, yeah. And he's even more unkillable.
Well, a little more of the same picks we've been seeing. Not as much flavor over in EU. Those guys were spicing things up all over the place today, but still the players feeling comfortable with these champions, and Charlie to leave his team on the stage for what could be the last time here as we go into game three. A possible final hug from the coaches, and this now, because of Team Liquid's hard work, their cohesion and team organization now surging at the end of the split. They have Cloud9 against the ropes for match point. As the teams load onto the Rift, be sure to let us know how you think this series is going to play out. Tweet at LOL Esports and use the hashtag C9Win or hashtag TLWin. And we'll be updating those throughout the game. We are in the third of this best of five series with Team Liquid looking to close it out. And we're about to be on the Rift. Cloud9 fighting for their LCS title lives here. See if they can get it. Now on to game three.
All right. This is kind of what CLG did when they were backed into a corner down 0-2 versus Team Liquid. They tried to plug up the other holes and gave away the Lulu. Let's see if Team Liquid can execute. Once again, Cloud9, they do have a set of champions that they are strong on as well. They have some important moves. Interesting from Team Liquid here, though. An odd level one, five-man down bottom. Sneaky will get the early warning.
Spotted out immediately.
Yeah. So pretty much foiled that plan.
Well, they're just brute-forcing their way into getting lane swap wards. It would seem like Sion can be immensely good in 1v2s. Kog'Maw also not someone who is super strong first 3 to 5 levels of a lane.
Yeah.
Lane swaps is actually something that Team Liquid desperately wants this game, but they are trading lane swap scouting. So at this point, if Cloud9 really wants to get the scouting information, it's available to both teams.
All right, yeah. So remember, these Kog'Maw compositions, they start to come online once your Kog'Maw has maxed the W and built a Trinity Force at least. Then you can start making moves. Before that, not so much.
Requires,
Cloud9, you know,
requires a lot of patience.
It does require patience. It also requires good positioning when you do move towards that mid-game and try and group up. Sion and Nunu do have pretty strong zone control.
And a lot of the early game will be about whether or not Cloud9 can make the right preparations to split push this game. That's one thing that hurts when you're running such a ball of death here for Team Liquid, is if they do start getting pressured by a 1-3-1, how well will they actually be able to engage? Because we know that Team Liquid has the ability to disengage, but as they're disengaging, can they poke? And can they deal with Cloud9 splitting high on Corki and balls on Hecarim and just making it a big old runaround game?
Yeah, definitely have to watch your flanks as well. A home-guarded Hecarim can ruin your day if you're trying to protect a single champion. Let's see, though. It all starts in the laning phase. Standard laning phase for Cloud9. Sneaky and Lemon getting some early strong positioning here.
Lemonation loves to take control of that brush.
Took the Krugs.
Looks like they'll be able to keep it safe. Obviously, Sneaky on the Lucian was able to push out Piglet each time that he's had it. Piglet obviously offering the same medicine as he gets it. Just a very aggressive early AD carry, and he's playing it nicely to keep that wave just in front of the turret as well.
At the very start of this lane, actually, Piglet was going to lane to set up the freeze, whereas Sneaky and Lemon were taking the Krugs. So as far as the battle of who gets the early experience in this series, this time it goes to Sneaky, and both times previously, the team that takes the early camp has had a pretty good time in the lane.
The other thing about running these protection compositions is that with the Nunu jungle, you don't exactly have a lot of early jungle pressure.
Is he going to be all right?
Yeah, he's fine.
Close.
He's fine. All right.
He's fine. 40 health. He's fine. One more hit from the big Raptor.
Hey, nerf the damage on the babies there.
Well, that's what we usually see from Meteos, going low, getting as much farm as he can before he tries to make an impact there. Still on the tank jungler, not something aggressive, which we saw a few times towards the end of the split from him. So still staying in that safe realm of coming out of the jungle for the team and being good for fights.
So I'm very curious to see if Meteos does try and focus bottom lane. Even if you don't get kills on Piglet, if you can delay the power of this Kog'Maw, if you can deny him CS, gain an advantage for Sneaky in the lane, try and bully this Kog'Maw around the map, then it does a lot for opening up that window for Cloud9 to try and take home some advantages.
Quas really dominating this lane, just being there 1v1 so far. 26 to 19 as he goes for a ward. Looks like he knows he's going to be pushing into that turret a little bit since Ball's letting it happen. Trying to stay safe all around the map.
Oh,
maybe
dear.
A little jungler intervention here for Meteos. Arctic Assault will apply that red buff if he can get the hit off. That's going to be under Special, forcing a flash here. That's a dead Special and Dominate. Too little, too late, was not able to offer assistance.
And that's going to heavily deny Piglet's farm moving later into this game. That's exactly the start that Cloud9 wanted. And as far as single points of failure going, if you're going to be playing Kog'Maw in this composition, even just in laning phase, Piglet had poor positioning right there for the ward control that the team had at the time. Easily capitalized on by Cloud9, and the best start they've had in the series.
Yep.
Maybe cheering up Bjergsen a little bit there after that tweet as well. Another pro kind of giving insight into what we're seeing on the cameras in between games here from the teams. Looks like Cloud9 had a pretty good talk, and so far have righted a bit of the early game. Not out of the woods yet. As Team Liquid wins this one, it's all over. Good push in the mid here. High, very aggressive within the minion wave.
Houdini.
He's gone. Not boots. Okay, so we got boots. Looking for that phage as well. Make sure that home guards come nice and early for him in the top lane. He also gets himself a ward here, knowing he'll push back on Quas as he backs. Tries to deny some of the CS, but so slow. Can't get pushed up after the roll.
So it's not a home guard rush. Because you would rush to your level 2. Interested to see what Boss has in mind for this lane. He's bought items to have a better lane phase for himself rather than have that really high impact teleport home guard. Because he was probably planning on using his teleport to get back the lane anyway, and he knew that he would not have the cooldown anytime soon. Your back is against the wall. You either play your best or fall. Dyrus with the rhymes.
He's a poet. Let's see. Their backs are quiet against the wall. I'm looking for big plays from Sneaky here. Both teams kind of looking for big plays from the AD carries out of this one.
This lane is really in the favor of Cloud9 right now.
Yeah.
A BF sword.
CS-wise and further positioning for how this lane's going to go.
Yeah, as far as protecting Piglet, he is nowhere near carry status, and he's not in a position to succeed in this lane.
So is the window that I was looking for. Mm. They opened it with Meteos. Now, let's see if Sneaky and Lemon can... Now, this is the line that you have to tread, because they want to play very aggressive. They want to deny as much CS as possible while they have the advantage. However, they cannot afford to have a Sion teleport in behind them and turn something around. If you coordinate that with a Nunu, even running down the lane, Nunu runs down the lane, blood boils. If a Sion is behind you already,
no escape.
Then they can close the distance, and the constant snowball spam is enough to chase you down a lane. So that's one thing that Cloud9 do have to worry about, is clearing the brush behind them. They do not want anything to upset this early lead that they have over Kog'Maw. They want to continue to punish him.
Yeah.
And the laning phase early on in this game is really favoring Cloud9. Hecarim over top of Sion. Phoenix, not the dominant player he was in game one and two, despite, because of the Sion pick, getting to choose to play Lulu in a sense against Corki. But I really, really wonder how set Team Liquid was on having Corki mid lane, Lulu top.
Right.
And that last picks of Corki Nautilus for Cloud9, whether or not that threw off Team Liquid's strategy, because honestly, I can see the logic behind the full tanks with a bunch of support, but that is so much more narrow of a team comp than having a Corki in the mid lane. And I don't know if Team Liquid got thrown off with that last pick, because in the laning phase, it's not
that last pick. So are you trying to do that?
With the what?
Never mind. Freak understand.
I'm not trying to say a last pick spot.
But yeah, you're right. The Corki is a bit of a takeaway from Phoenix.
Seems like it. It definitely, for locking in Sion, Nunu, Lulu, Kog'Maw, let's wait the entire time, right, to lock in that or lock in our last champion.
Ooh,
rather.
He's doing just what we said. Hey, Pink Ward in both rush behind them. Good job, Lemonation and Cloud9.
Denying the Sion teleport.
All the suggestions for bottom lane. They've got their heads in the right space. Meteos comes early. Pink Ward behind us. Oh, doesn't matter. They're lined up. Like, okay.
The wave's pushing the wrong way, though. That would be...
Well, the thing is, Sion's much more threatening if he's already behind you. If he comes down
he's
the lane,
going,
you can
though.
Hear him coming. Oh, good knock.
Boom!
Ooh. Not
that hard to miss a
JK.
Who needs Nunu?
Run straight down the lane.
The power of Kwas.
The power of Kwas, indeed. Look at him. Stone cold right on the camera.
Well, now Cloud9's got to try and take a turret for these dragons. Instead of contesting the dragons, get turret trades. How well can Team Liquid stop them from doing this?
A little bit of deja vu here. A teleport top lane from Kwas will stop the turret from fully going down. Dominate, as usual, gets the dragon with the team for the first one. And they get themselves a good bit of ground there with the early game going to Cloud9. That was good for them to pick up and hopefully can start to kind of filter into their lanes and add pressure there. We're seeing this composition of Phoenix not do well in the mid lane, who is supposed to be the guy that's going to buff up Piglet, so that's all kind of falling apart for them really early.
Well, let's see what Ball's answer will be, because now he's got a teleport advantage. He knows that he has a teleport advantage because he saw Kwas teleport back to his lane. Even though it is on the turret reduced cooldown, he is at the point where his next purchase he could get home guards and try to even up the influence on the bottom lane. Let's see, he decides to try and move across the map and make some plays, or just stay in his lane.
We have to remember as well how difficult it is to beat a team three times in a row. Team Liquid, last year in the third place match against LMQ, was up 2-0. And this was before a string of best of fives would go 2-0 in one side and then end 3-2 for the other team.
Yeah.
Obviously, Team Liquid has the built-up confidence of beating COG 3-0 prior, and they're still technically in hold of the momentum, but that will be in the back of their heads that the series is not over.
Absolutely.
Until you win that third game.
Especially more for the players that were in that experience. Three of them still remaining on the team here. Squash, Dominate, and Pick Special as they push out the lane, keeping themselves safe, and they still hold the bottom turret. With Quas going back to get that top turret and them grabbing Dragon, very nice move to stop Cloud9 getting any early advantage. Just 2K gold sits in their pocket right now. A Phage also finished up on high here. See if they can start using Triforce spikes within the next eight or so minutes.
That'll be the moment where Cloud9 wants to turn on. We know that the Team Liquid team composition needs a lot of patience before they can get the Protect the Kog'Maw going. But because of the 40 CS lead that Sneaky has on Piglet, there's a good chance that Cloud9 can actually get two Trinity Forces done before Piglet gets his first. And if Cloud9 can force during that window, they could take complete control of this game.
Very aggressive trades as well towards the bottom lane. You can almost see on the minimap the icons just laying on top of each other the entire time as Kwas balls go head-to-head. Looks like High is getting some free time in middle. There was a lead in CS by Phoenix from the roaming being done by Cloud9, but that seems to be evened up on both sides now as Dominic gets himself into position. So Liquid's doing all the right things, getting back into position to stop Cloud9's pushes here. But neither team's getting too much out of this lull.
Yep, Dominate early sights on Nunu, no surprise there. Mm-hmm. Tries to get vision down for his team, tries to provide that early warning system so that none of the side lanes fail. Trying to ensure an easier income for their Kog'Maw on the bottom side.
It's all about the waiting game. But Piglet is a time bomb in this one.
He is. Most of the wards are being used fairly defensively so far for Team Liquid. And they still haven't been able to completely clean their jungle. That's not really a big problem for them because, as we've already seen, Sion with the lane ganks or Sion with the teleport is what the real issue is going to be. And they don't really have a heavy gank jungler, so the moves coming out of the jungle won't really be that surprising. Cloud9 Cloud9. Interesting move here from Meteos. He does have ult available. Ooh, he's going to catch Phoenix in the pinch here, but Hai's not in position to capitalize. Wants this cannon minion.
He's going pretty deep. Seeing these two here could definitely allow Cloud9 to try and force something. You see Balls all the way pushed up, trying to just suck up some minion turrets in that top lane before they can even get to Quas.
Yep.
Looks like going to give him trouble, make him stay. We'll see Balls start to deny that jungle farm. And looks like they're the one making moves here as Team Liquid's kind of try to figure it out. Cloud9's going to try to give themselves an advantage. Ever so slowly, though, nobody wants to really make too big of a move.
Well, Cloud9 is making sure not to jump the gun before they are legitimately powerful. They definitely want Hai to get about 500 more gold so he can go back to base and buy that Trinity Force.
Yeah, Balls
might
rushed
sync
into
with
it.
Dragon.
So Balls rushed into the Trinity Force build instead of grabbing the home guard. So they're actually going...
He might just be trying to beat up. Whoa, Phoenix took a lot of damage.
Whoa, doggy. Don't think he expected that right away.
Let's see what Balls can do with this completed Trinity Force, because at the moment, Quas is already heading to the bottom side of the map. He just changed directions here. I feel like Cloud9 are making the call to have Balls just split push and grab the money from the turret rather than the dragon. I said that last time, though, and they tried to fight the dragon.
There's a distinct difference in this game, though, where they have the edge almost either way.
He actually has the Trinity Force this time, so
yeah.
That's the big difference here. And he's level 11, so Balls is Cloud9's biggest tool at the moment. Sneaky's also got an Infinity Edge, though, so... Bottom lane.
They've hit their power spikes for the most part.
Yep. Let's see here. Knockdown mid turret instead. So Cloud9 actually not going to give up Dragon number two, it looks like. They want to take down mid turret, try and get that vision around the Dragon area.
Something they can do fast. The ones Hecarim, the Triforce, the Balls with their, or rather Hai with his Sheen get there on Corki. Those turrets are not going to be standing very long. So Cloud9 finally open up the middle of the map. Maybe some forward wards to come in now for some Hecarim teleports.
He
had about 80 gold
can
to
they
himself,
knock it down?
Though. I don't think he has the money to get the home guards just yet. Now,
with
Jonna
there too,
Kobe,
they should definitely be in.
Liquid looks like they could push mid, but Meteos is here.
Solo wave clear from Sej, and they all back up. They have no deep wards. That may be a small instance where no deep wards cost them. They don't know that's only Sejuani, but... Good defense there for Cloud9. Yep. That's actually very important for them because Balls also was able to shove another wave into the turret, and he's got position on Quas. Looks like it'll just be for some more proxy farming here behind the turret.
Yeah, Team Liquid is having their cake and eating it too right now. They have lane pressure as well as not giving up dragons. It's because they just finished that double Trinity Force, so not only do they have the power in lane, yes, Cloud9, but also they have the power over the potential dragon fight.
Yep. Really surprised this Kog'Maw has not seen more pressure towards the early game. They tried a few times, were able to get special, but nothing out of that Cog. With the dragon alive here, we see Balls on the rotation down, even with that teleport up.
Team Liquid knows it's coming. Dominate had dropped about four wards in the river here around dragon. So you can sweep out a couple, but they're everywhere down there.
Cloud9, total control of this dragon area.
Now,
and they can even teleport back to the top lane if they want to save things off. This is Cloud9. Really taking it to Team Liquid in the early game.
And it's a good choice for Team Liquid not to drop more by trying to contest that dragon before they've actually completed a Trinity Force for Piglet, before he's been able to max and just keep Quas up top. So Team Liquid, good choice to seed. Cloud9, good choice to force it and take some advantage here. Let's see if they can knock down this turret with something else. Looks like everybody from Team Liquid backing off, so it'll be just the turret. Balls has not opted to teleport back to the turret at topside, though, so Quas able to hack it down. This is
a good lead for him in the top lane. Keeps it strong. That's 1-1 now on the kill board. 2-1 in those turrets. It's finally one that Quas was able to pick up. If they can do the out of line, that's a huge surge in gold for them, but that could be the 3K difference they're looking at right now.
What I want now for Cloud9 is for them to force more objectives. That was a good start.
Right.
But they need to continue to press their advantage right now.
Yeah, I mean, especially with Kog'Maw off in this side lane, potentially freezing. It looks like he's going to push off the wave a little bit. Cloud9 basically has to go top lane or hard 4 to 5 man push mid and just start taking the turrets in a chain of events. They need to keep pressure on multiple locations, one guy shoving a lane, probably balls, everyone else farming and pushing, and never letting Team Liquid group up with power spike.
And I think that they have that idea. That's why they had Balls hold onto his teleport. They want it for a cross-map play. They want to make a play soon. They don't want to have to wait for 4 minutes. And so they're going to have him position him bottom. He doesn't have the home guards completed, so he can actually just be in the lane and teleport up.
Right.
He's not going to have to base to the fountain first.
This can be an extended push from Cloud9. They're making the rotation that they might want to try and get two turrets.
There's the one in top. Kwas not going to be able to do much here, and Cloud9 is finally putting their foot down here. The advantage is able to be kept. Moving the wards forward, it's only Balls that's really getting trouble, but this means with the resources here from Liquid, you have to expect Cloud9's going to get something in the top lane, and that could be Kwas along with that second tier turret. He could go down quite fast, ulting to get out. Depth Charge is going to hit that up, but they may not be able to chase all the way under. Meteos going a little too deep here. They should already be on that turret with a minion wave, and they may not get much more than damage onto Kwas.
Do not forget the priority of objectives right there for Cloud9. They commit so heavily onto that kill. They don't even get the turn out of it, but it costs them a turret of their own on the side.
Strong play
there.
Big
mistakes.
Kwas got big fast. That Giant's Bout keeps him alive with a 15-minute frozen heart that he built 5 minutes ago.
The fact that Cloud9 has an Infinity Edge, a Static Shift, and a Pickaxe on Lucian, the Pickaxe just now, versus Piglet, who didn't even have a Trinity Force, and Team Liquid gets an advantageous turret trade, it speaks to the level of that mistake of trying to kill Sion.
Yep. Yeah, exactly. It's the choice right there. Piglet and Xspecial focus the turret. They only deal damage to Balls when he comes out for CS. The dive there from Cloud9, definitely more than they could actually capitalize on. Let's see, though. They still are riding this spike, and they still have the teleport. They do not have the ultimates, though, from Nautilus or Sedge, so they probably have to wait for those to come back up. That might really be a problem.
A 1,700 gold lead for Sneaky over Piglet's Kog'Maw is rather immense at this point. But if you compare it with the protection that he will be receiving, you add the Blood Boil, the Lulu picks, and the Janna Shield, Kog'Maw would still be stronger as an individual.
Right. It's all about saving that Juggernaut. Can he be kept alive? Right now, Meteos actually doesn't get tagged there, so they don't have follow-up vision on the entire C9 team. And they don't have the wards either. Those are being cleared out quite nicely by Cloud9. Team Liquid only sees their half of the jungle now, and that means C9 can start to make these moves. Looks like they're going to get Balls to split push in the bottom lane. Still yet to finish those home guards, so it's just going to be regular TPs.
Already 1-3-1 from Cloud9, but immediately Team Liquid is ready to push down mid lane. They have the Trinity Force on Kog'Maw, which is the moment they want to start protecting. And that's actually the moment Cloud9 could have won a fight, I feel like, because they have the power spikes on the appropriate champions, but they're trying to pressure these side waves. Cloud9 has to make the turrets count somehow.
I feel like if Balls had upgraded home guards instead of getting the mantle or the cowl there, then the play was possible for him to teleport in behind at that mid turret. But without that purchase, you can see he's just going for the team fight. He's not looking for home guard plays.
All right.
Speaking of plays,
they don't even have the Blade of the Rune thing yet, just the Cutlass. This could be difficult.
He's going to try for a steal. That's a real low Baron.
Dominate flash is over. It's going to be going to Meteos, though, on the smite. Dominate couldn't get the bite off. He only got his smite.
He bit it really early when it was at like 2K.
He did bit it then. Okay. Not working out for him, and it is going to be still Team Liquid that can organize and micro themselves back into the fight, figuring out the position that they need to push Cloud9 off. They have Baron, and they're going to have to work the minion waves well. It's definitely not going to be coming from Lemon Nation, though. He goes down trying to throw that last bit of shield
on. Mid lane as well.
This could be big. It could also be Balls going down if he can fly fast enough up to the team for safety, and it looks like Balls will just try to get a push on. What a call for Baron there.
Yeah, 3 kills for Baron. Not exactly worth. We'll see if in the ensuing push, if Cloud9 are able to recoup some of that gold.
Cloud9 was going for a home run right there, hoping to sneak the Baron. But you could see if they overcommit to the Baron that time, it is a little bit tricky for
them
to go.
It could have been much
there.
Worse for them. If Dominate had
disaster.
If he had actually added up the consume and the smite. See, he jumps in here. He actually consumes it at like 1,700.
Okay, so he did it immediately.
So he did the combo. He just did it way too early. So
yeah. thing is, I think he had to flash in blind there.
Yeah,
he didn't
no
have wards on
You're
the
right.
inside.
Yeah.
Even so, the follow-up teamfight was pretty strong from Team Liquid, even without Piglet being there. But now because of the Baron and the extended nature of that fight, Cloud9 picks up another dragon. And I still feel like they have control of this game for the most part. Mm-hmm.
Yes,
sir. Fights going the way of Team Liquid has not pushed down Cloud9 off their pedestal that they've worked up to this game three. Still a bit of a gold lead, and the second dragon going their way. Makes number three, four, one's Team Liquid might want to pressure being the team that loves dragons.
Cloud9 definitely need to keep up the pressure, that's for sure.
For
they
sure.
want to use this Baron buff. They've got, how many times, I'm going to stop saying it, but teleport from balls is ready.
he's really, going to home guard sometime.
Go for going
to home guard. He's not going to home guard. He's going to teleport, though.
Cloud9, really slow.
Let's see how many turrets they can take off the back of this Baron buff.
Ooh, hello. Ooh. That's not going to be fun for him.
So, here's a maybe problem.
All right, maybe problem.
For Cloud9 is they have no way of killing Quas unless they've killed everyone else first. Because even just Quas sitting there with a Frozen Heart and Randwinds is difficult for Cloud9 to take down. If they commit any shielding to him, no way he dies in a 10-minute fight. He
Jugger Quas?
Yeah. So therefore, Cloud9 has to work completely around Quas. And the gold lead may not be as impactful as we thought, since Team Liquid can be so efficient in their itemization. They only need one person to get the kills in order to maximize their damage, and they only need to build one type of resistance in order to minimize Cloud9's damage.
Well, they were talking about those threats on the analyst desk for Team Liquid. It seems like they've organized those threats cleanly this game. That Ha-Hai is looking for the Blade of the Rune King, but we just saw him getting ice-balled by Nunu, then the Frozen Hearts. He's not going to be able to do much anyways.
Baron's falling off there. Mm-hmm. I don't see them getting any more turrets
Quas just 2v1-ing. No worries.
He wants to kill him. Oh, that Randwinds would have prepped an ult.
There's
That's
the roar. He's going to have to get the flash out of Sneaky. Still has a bit of a gap closer with his relentless pursuit. And there the team comes in. That's going to be the teleport from Balls here. No home guard still for him, but he's going to be in the middle of the fight and able to go with the onslaught of shadows immediately in place. Hit by Quas coming in. He's going to try to do as much as he can in that passive. And it's not going to be much. Cloud9 find a pretty decent fight, one for one. Will they get more out of it, though?
They got a minion wave to crash into the top turret, but...
Right.
I mean...
No, I think Team Liquid comes ahead in that fight. The supports weren't there for Quas at the start, but the fact that Quas can still build tanky right there, and the fact that the kill went on to Piglet, as well as stopping a potential split push, it is a trade in the slight favor of Team Liquid.
Yeah, they did get the teleport out.
Clawing their way back.
They got the teleport out from Hecarim, so...
And they saved all the turrets.
That's really the surprise move that Cloud9 had in their pockets. And surprise, one for one, because Zion passive is ridiculous.
The strangest thing to me about this game is that Cloud9, with this double AD carry and a Hecarim, they are a split push, objective focused, turret taking team. Yet, decision after decision throughout these 27 minutes have been Cloud9 peeling back for fights and going for kills. And they only have three kills, so those kills they've been chasing, they're not even getting for the most part.
Right.
Cloud9 could easily have five turrets in this game, and that would translate to a 7,000 or 8,000 gold lead if you count everything else they could have gotten from that. Mm-hmm. They're misplaying their hand a little bit, and it's leaving the door open for Team Liquid to take this game from behind.
The top turret that they aggressed under previously before is still at 75% health, so you are correct. The objective focus a little awry right now for C9, but the defensive focus, that's being dictated for them by Liquid now as they push him towards the mid turret. Just a quick tidal wave to clear off.
Do they have
minions.
The flank? Watch for Sejuani.
Well, Hecarim's pretty far, and Hecarim also.
Oh, the hesitation. What a grouping that was. Now he tries to follow up. The Arctic Assault is only going to push Dominate a little bit here. The teleport comes in from Quas. That could be ringing the dinner bell down the mid lane. Looks like he's going to hold on to it. Quas does not ult.
That was actually a very good collapse from Cloud9 to draw the teleport out of Team Liquid.
And patience will be the name of the game on both sides right here. Meteos needs to have patience with the Sejuani ultimate so he can land it on a priority target. And as well, Team Liquid needs to have patience to not over-engage before they're
Those
strong.
Buttons are close.
They're real close.
A little fumble-risky.
You never know. The crab just sometimes it just...
He'll
run away from a random direction. You gotta stay on top of that sucker.
Yep. It's a tricky one.
Nobody fools Dominate. He missed the flash consume on Baron, but he'll get that
he'll
grab
get that
every
grab.
Time. Every time.
There he is. Yeah. Oh, clearing wards too. He is versatile this game. Trying to be omnipresent, stick with the team. He's participated in 3 of the 5 kills with those assists. And he is also the owner of a Frozen Heart as well, as they stack 2 of those. Phoenix picking up a Luden's Echo to help out him with speed, and definitely a lot of clear coming from Lulu now if Cloud9 can approach these turrets.
We did have that soundbite from X Special about how heavy is the rest of Cloud9 for Sneaky to carry them. Well, Sneaky is doing extremely well this game, and he's going the right itemization build.
Yeah.
If he finishes Blade of the Ruined King, with Last Whisper being completed, there's a chance he can start cutting through some of these tanks and shields from
Yeah,
him.
How heavy are the tanks on the front line of Team Liquid, though? He's got a lot of meat to move. He's got so much work ahead of him trying to push those guys out.
Oh, this is a lot of people close to each other. Maybe we get a fight here.
Party in the Bramble Pit! Big Balls flies in with Onslaught of Shadows. The Monsoon kicks back Cloud9, but can they organize and assess who they want to kill? Yeah, it's going to be Dominate first. They melt him down. Meteos over the wall now, and this is Cloud9 not following, not going for the fight. Can they get something out of it, though? Unfortunately,
their
not.
Their HP is very low.
That was a big, big one.
They are going to ping Baron right now.
Yep.
That's very risky just because the shields from Team Liquid. They can they're just going to go.
Well, they're
just going to try and burn it
down.
It's
not a 50-50 smite, so
Quas would
have
to ultimate right now. There we go.
Quas hits it. Boom. Oh, he makes it into the pit! Threads the needle, the Baron entrance! He gets in! Cloud9 is all tanking that Baron before it went down! Ball's going hard onto Piglet now! Phoenix and X-Special very low! They clean up Quas, but his death body is going to be very scary! They leave Lemonation in the pit by himself! Great shots from Sneaky to take down Quas, and Cloud9 have completely put themselves in the lead here, without a doubt.
This time, they put it all on the line for the Baron. Take it, because Nunu's down. No threat there, even with Quas jumping right in. Ooh, it paid off for Cloud9. This Baron buff, they really, really need to make count.
Oh yeah, and you could see the lack of damage there from Team Liquid at this point in the game. The Scion not contributing, the Nunu not having a Blood Boil to help out Piglet, and everyone on Cloud9 getting away with slivers. The diving from Balls as Hecarim and the sustained damage from the double AD carries is doing its toll right now. Cloud9, smart take for this Dragon.
Using those advantages very well now. The map is obviously going to be clear of Team Liquid bodies for the time being. Easy breathing room here for Cloud9 to extend that lead even more. The third Dragon now, 4 and 5 are very close, and they'll probably be theirs. But they got to get these waves pushed out first. This bottom wave was gigantic, so Sneaky could be going for another one here.
How many swords can Sneaky buy? Because he needs every single kind. Now with the Bork, he actually has the means to chop up some of that frontline meat. He's already got the armor penetration. He already has Infinity Edge crits. See if this is the push that Cloud9 take inside the base. They really, really have to focus this one. Because after that last fight, crucial, crucial part of that last fight, Piglet is down both summoners.
Yeah, and it's not like Balls as Hecarim is an easy target for Piglet to slice through.
No, this is a guy.
He doesn't even have his third major completed item.
And Quas has been building for these team fights the entire time. He's
still no home guards.
He still doesn't even have home guards. He's going full on, sit on Piglet's face with the frozen heart, and try to deny his damage. Try and contain all of that throw up from Kog'Maw.
Yeah, the poke coming in pretty heavy from Cloud9 here. They're making this Baron count, finally focusing on the turrets. Top lane split push, mid lane take it down.
It does not look like there's much that can stop this Cloud9 team.
Not done yet.
Yeah,
where's the hook?
Low from
Piglet
the poke.
At 33%.
They're just brute forcing their way in. Lemonation doesn't even really throw the hook on that one. He's just walking around being Nautilus. Ball's going to tank the turret for the team as they head to the top lane here. Most can make it through the wall, but Lemonation can't.
Uh-oh.
Oh, they leave him out to dry. He's tanky enough, however, to keep the fight going. Lemonation is
still
fighting
the turret.
As the team, yes, is taking the turret, and then they might be helping him. Priorities getting all switched around, but it looks like they still have enough of the advantage that priorities don't even matter at this point for Team Liquid. They roll into the base. So close to getting kills on Piglet and Phoenix. The guys who have been the carry for Team Liquid are running for safety.
But a single point of failure, low damage. You're seeing this Cloud9 lead, and the tanks that they have accumulated are too beefy for Team Liquid to cut through. Two inhibitors down for Cloud9.
Cloud9 look like they've pulled it off. They really are not done here. This would be the lowest that they have ever placed. This would be the first time they haven't gotten to the finals.
Yep.
They weren't able to make a comeback. And Team Liquid got to hold it together.
Yeah, Cloud9 in big position. I mean, just looking at this fight, you think, all right, they got Lemonation caught. Easy, right? Piglet is in the back, though, can't immediately damage. And Cloud9 says, you're going to waste time with the support. Time to kill the turret. Sneaky is a huge damage threat. Piglet is immediately in retreat mode because of the Sejuani ultimate that Meteos was able to extend onto Piglet.
I feel like that was a late Mikhail. Does he? I think he also needs a QSS or something.
Yeah.
Piglet did not get off almost any auto attacks that entire fight.
That'll hurt your damage.
So, you know what hurts your auto attack spacing? Not being able to auto attack.
Absolutely.
I'm gonna remember that one.
Auto attack spacing just goes up with attack speed. Quick tip.
Not even really getting the living artillery's out from the pack either. 4-0-1, and he cannot be the Kog'Maw that needs to carry this Phantom Dancer. Will definitely be good assistance to getting and chunking through Meteos and Balls right now. He has the Blade of the Rune King, but still all eyes on Piglet as he picks up that red buff to help his spacing out a little bit.
Is he ever going to finish Phantom Dancer? All right, finally.
Okay.
He completes it. Still no Last Whisper.
He was waiting till you said something.
Would have to be his next item, I'd imagine. Cloud9 can be patient with this as well if they need to be. Two waves of super minions, and Team Liquid only has one person who can clear those minion waves, and it's Kog'Maw. If Kog'Maw clears a minion wave, the third inhibitor falls.
Yeah.
Cloud9 just needs to be patient.
The clock is ticking as the minions enter the base in both top and mid wave.
Oh, Sneaky.
By himself in a very scary spot. Does get hit by Quas there off of the ultimate. He's going to die immediately. And it looks like Cloud9 may have to rethink this fight. Dominate's coming out quick. He's the one with the Blood Boil and the Wild Growth on. So he tries to continue initiating, but there's not enough chase. And it looks like Cloud9, even with losing one of their damage threats, can still keep going. But make sure everybody's on the same page first.
Fighting with the minion waves as best they can. Cloud9.
Yeah.
Sticking around with no Sneaky here.
No
Phoenix
Sneaky, no Baron.
Over to try and handle the supers.
That's what they were waiting for. Cannot get enough damage from Phoenix to clear the waves, and they have gotten Winions to take out one of the Nexus turrets. Bottom wave will be cleared a little bit easier with that inhibitor being up, but a great time play, if you will. Very timely.
This is a tense one. Team Liquid holding on. Quas with a great move there, taking initiative, taking matters into his own hands when he sees Sneaky split up. I didn't hear who that was for.
Yeah. I heard there was a chant for someone.
I mean, it sounded
quieter.
Like a rally.
Let's go.
Someone.
Yeah.
Go League of Legends.
Well, we're definitely going to get more due to the result of this game. It looks like Cloud9 wants to push it to a game four. We're going to get another series out of this one if they can keep putting their foot down this strong. The Righteous Glory finished up recently by Lemonation to continue these fights. And even though Piglet's finishing up all of his damage, he's only going to be eating more with that Thornmail onto Balls now. So not even getting easier as they get to this later game.
He's gone double lifesteal this early in the build because
that's
he knows
true.
He
yeah,
has to fight
hurt.
Through the Hecarim. But as far as actually trying to get back in the driver's seat for Team Liquid here, without their base to help manage minion waves, since all their buildings are dead,
yeah,
they're in a real tough place. It does feel like Cloud9 still just needs to be patient here. Control the area around the Baron Pit, and then just take the Baron.
Man, to see how much that put a kink in the idea of Team Liquid and Champion
balls
Select.
Get caught.
Oh dear. That's the vision on him. Phoenix
Heads
is coming
old.
In with Whimsy. 5 seconds of speed there. Forced on the onslaught of Shadows to get out. This is going to be Baron going down. They take down Dominate with the help of High over the wall firing some of those missiles. And remember this, Lemon's a little too tanky to take down.
In.
This fight went for Cloud9 last time they was in the base. Piglet dies immediately. Akathian surprise is going to take down high. It actually does not take him down. He has a sliver of health.
GG,
that's
Cloud9.
Gonna be it. Amazing.
They power their way through this one. Clean up some extra kills here on Quas, and they are gonna take this.
You look at the damage of Team Liquid, though, and the damage of Cloud9. These protect the carry strategies are so one-dimensional. At this point, if you can't win a team fight, you can't do much. And every time they ended up trying a team fight, Cloud9 took them down. Sneaky is huge. Next inhibitor turret is going down. This should be game.
With their backs against the wall and a stutter step in champion select, Team Liquid fall here in game three. 12-8, 38 minutes in, Cloud9 stays alive, and we got a game four.
These best of five series.
Woo. That sigh from Balls, the whole team as well. A big sigh of relief there that the hopes of the title are still alive for this spring split.
Yeah, congratulations to Cloud9 for winning Game 3. So their season and hopes of the NALCS championship remain alive. They still know they have a lot of work to do, however. They need to be able to do what Team Liquid could not and win three games in a row if they want to move on.
Doesn't this set up the the three games against Liquid again, though? The curse? Oh, man. Once again, it could come true, but they've shown different this year. That was pretty apparent from Champion Select. They had to call an audible, and it wasn't something they were ready for. Every game that they've played so far was kind of dictated at their own pace, making Cloud9 make mistakes. But when Cloud9 got that upper hand, it was pretty clean for them.
Three bans on Phoenix.
Always, right? Ban that guy out.
They kind of force them, kind of bait them, let them go for the Lulu mid.
Yeah.
Right.
And
literally the almost same composition.
High has control of the mid lane.
Boom.
That was pretty big, the fact that High had control of the mid lane on that Corki. Yes, Cloud9 won that game. I'm still, I hate to be that guy that harkens back to Champions Left. I'm still surprised that Team Liquid locked in Kog'Maw with Corki on the board, because they have had success with the exact Corki Kog'Maw and the other things around it, team composition in the past. Mm-hmm. And it's not like Cloud9 is going to take Kog'Maw with no protection. It could have been an easy last pick to lock it in. And because the Corki got taken away from them, they lost that extra dimension in their team comp. They were overly tanky, single source of damage, and Cloud9 split pushed them to death.
Well, with that win now, Cloud9 are on the board. Gentlemen, the fans are happy. They were cheering for Cloud9 as they came out. I guess it gave them a little boost of power. So right now we're going to send it over to the analyst desk to walk us through their first win of the series.
Thank you, Riv and Cloud9, making me a liar there. I get to join the table of liars to liars.
Desk.
Losers. Whatever you want to call it.
How does it feel to be the head of the loser desk?
I mean, the head of the losers is better than being just a loser, right? I guess. I'll take it. Anyway, let's talk about Cloud9's victory here, because we were actually kind of pushing them towards maybe putting more pressure onto Sneaky's shoulders, grabbing that Kog'Maw for him, and going into that, you know, hyper carry ADC kind of a team comp. Well, they do the opposite. They give it away, and they still come out with the victory.
Well, it's interesting. I know I like floundered around a whole lot when you're like, what should C9 do? And I'm like, it's like 17 things they could do. They went with the hey, balls, go be crazy one, right? Because he did great in game one. He beat up Quas there, and he just managed to follow through on it. And I know you were like the entire game, like, oh my God, balls is huge. He's getting bigger and bigger. He's like up 100 CS this game. He was like level 18 for everyone else. And right at the very end, you heard the commentators say it, getting split pushed to death, right? Like, you have only one threat. It's only the Kog'Maw, and Hecarim's going to keep applying pressure and keep making life difficult. C9 got a Baron off of it, and then they just kind of kept control. They kept a gold lead, and there was really no easy way in for the, you know, the Kog'Maw-based composition, because there's too many things going on. You can't react to all of them.
And something I liked, the adaptation there, was they didn't ban the Lulu. They left it open. They basically baited Team Liquid into picking this comp, because as soon as they get Lulu, they're going to go Juggermaw full on. And then Meteos just started ganking bottom. He put the pressure in the lane that they had that was winning and just shut that down. He's like, all right, immediately push that out. And then CS advantage across the board. High was able to keep even and a little bit ahead of Phoenix at some points.
Yeah.
And the fact that he picked a very safe champion for him, I think is something that Cloud9 needs to continue to do this series. Because on Lissandra, he was having basically no impact and falling behind. Yeah. On Corki, you can have like pretty moderate, even no impact, but he'll still stay up in CS. He'll stay safe, and I think that's really good for High.
Yeah, Sorry, go ahead.
I think like the two biggest things this game that happened for Cloud9 that was really important is, first of all, they got high on a pressuring mid lane champion, Corki. I feel like Corki's like his best champion right now in the meta, where he's pressuring Phoenix in. Phoenix isn't on his best champions, and when Phoenix isn't on that Azir, that Vlad, that Urgot, he doesn't have that pressure that he usually does on those champions, and he's not like doing as well. And the other thing is Meteos got that bottom lane pressure off. Even though he was playing Sejuani, he got Sneaky ahead. He got him snowballed so that they could just keep pressuring and snowball the game with all that split push and just constantly farming up while Team Liquid couldn't do anything with their carry comp. And I think that Corki pick is just going to be very important for the series.
Yeah, looking at Team Liquid and how they seem to be caught off guard with that Corki pickup. We talked about the possibility of them having to pivot into that Sion pick. And I mean, we can't, obviously we can't confirm that. You see them here on your screens. They're clearly talking about the loss that they just got handed, and they're going to have to regroup and try and come back and make it a 3-1. But without knowing whether or not the Lulu was always intended to go mid, I have to wonder, when Phoenix was applying so much pressure in the mid lane and really having a handle on that matchup,
right,
they put him on to Lulu, and he does struggle a little bit against that Corki.
Yeah, I think it's a bit of squandered resources here, right? Like, Phoenix hard carried game two. He was like the reason they won. He dunked on lane, and then he absolutely crushed team fights. I want to see him on an Impact champion. I think Team Liquid can reliably expect Phoenix to be a bigger threat than high, provided they give him a half-decent matchup. Lulu and a Corki, not really a great one. I want to see him with something actually much more aggressive, something that can make a whole bunch of plays. And there's more champions there. He can play Xerath, he's a good damage threat. He can play some Ahri, he can play some Zed himself, he can play Cassiopeia. All these are very good high-damage champions.
I think the biggest question for this game four is, how deep is Phoenix's champion pool really? Because usually in a best of five, you run one strategy and you keep running that strategy until they beat it. And finally, Cloud9 found something that works. They banned out three mid champions from Phoenix. The question is, does Phoenix have a fourth champion? Does he have something that is he's that strong on? Maybe it's Corki. Maybe they're going to take away Corki. I feel like the Lulu going mid instead of going top was not that impactful for Team Liquid.
Yeah, that's the thing, is they need pressure from that mid lane. They did have the Sion, but he got four levels behind, down 100 CS. Like, throwing a Lulu up in the top lane, that same situation is going to have a better time, right? If you're 100 CS down as Lulu, four levels down, you're like, oh, I'm still doing Lulu things. I'm still buffing the Kog'Maw, right? If they're mid laner, they could have picked pretty much anything in that situation, and it would have been a little bit better for them because they would have had another threat because it was all on Piglet's shoulders.
Yeah, honestly, so we talk about things on Piglet's shoulders, and, you know, you can see single threat comps
like
work.
I think about it, I'm like, an Orianna would have been okay, too.
Sure, just another damage dealing, like, semi support.
Yeah.
Just and I agree. Yeah, I mean, I do like seeing teams diversify. Again, and at the very beginning, we talked about C9, how they diversified a little bit. Balls was a big split push threat, got them Baron, that's huge, right? And against a new team, dear God, like, the levels of awesome there are pretty high. But it was cool to see C9, like, have everyone pitch in. Right? So much of this game is on Sneaky's shoulders, and Sneaky is still performing. Even in losses, I feel like Sneaky's score lines and contributions are quite high, but he crushed the bottom lane, and he got help, so good job everyone else, and then crushed bot lane even harder. High won his lane, sick. Balls won his lane, also sick. And so everyone here is contributing from C9, and like, you were talking about how deep is Phoenix's champion pool, you know, can he be brought down? Well, High got brought up, right? We're like, all right, come into the playoffs. High can play Liss, and High can play Zed. And we saw Liss get stomped. We saw Zed basically getting preemptively counterpicked. Well, Corki's here, though, by the way. And, like, if High can keep putting in these performances and going 10% above Phoenix, then this is almost an easy series for C9.
We're almost seeing the number of power players on each team shift.
Yeah.
As we saw the pick and ban phase alter, right? Because you get rid of all of what we said was Phoenix's power champions there in the mid lane, and then you take the Corki away from him, you're relegating him to someone that isn't going to be a playmaker, if anything, and then also someone that he might not be quite as comfortable on. In the meantime, you therefore boost High's performance.
Yeah.
Someone who in the previous games had already played Corki, you know, and we said, he didn't play so great on his first Corki game, wasn't that impressive. But when you give him the edge in that mid lane, he can use that to his advantage and strengthen their team. So I feel like for Team Liquid, their challenge now is to get back to that multi-threat strategy. Because in that game, they were a single threat.
And here's the thing about Liquid. Best of fives are what they love. We constantly talk about Team Liquid, how they have a million strategies out there. When they played CLG, they played three different comps. Here, they've played roughly four different comps. Here, okay, Juggernaut's not the comp. Toss it out. You got two more games to play. Whatever. They're going to have other things to play here. I'm so confident that Team Liquid have other comps to play. The question is now just momentum, right? Does it crack at the seams? Maybe. Like, we saw them, you know, summer split against LMQ. They started 2-0, then they lost 3 in a row. This is always a possibility.
Lastly, again, as we have Team Liquid back up on your screen, Zion, momentum, Freak just touched on it. They started up 2-0. They've been in this situation before and had it run back against them 3-2. I mean, these discussions right now, you've been in this scenario as well. What are we talking about here? What do you ignore as a team, and what do you focus on in order to make sure you can come back in with the right mindset to pull out a win?
I think what a lot of people don't realize, the momentum is literally one of the biggest, if not the biggest factor going into the long series, where it closes up like 2-0, 2-1, like 2-2. The pressure's on, the pressure's mounting. Like, do you have somebody to bring the team back up, to focus in on what's important? Like, you don't want those doubts in the back of your mind, like, are we actually going to lose this? Like, are we actually good enough as a team? You need to be as a team, and you need to unite yourselves. And that's really hard to do sometimes when you're losing games like that and you're not really sure what happened.
All right, well, we saw them there finish up their discussions. Hopefully that means they are all on the same page and they're ready to go. Cloud9, though, have kept the series alive with that important win. After the break, we'll see if they can keep the momentum on their side, rather, in Game 4. Don't go anywhere.
All right. The Hecarim loss is a fluke. Hecarim 100% win rate, OP. Confirm, let's do it.
That's a real low Baron. Dominate flash is over. It's going to be going to Meteos though on the smite. Dominate couldn't get the bite off. He only got his smite. Oh, he makes it into the pit. Threats the needle, the Baron entrance. He gets in. Cloud9 is all tanking that Baron before it went down.
Jared's dead.
They're killing Lemon. Phoenix is half.
Can we go in?
We can fight. Careful.
Go, Piglet, Piglet.
I'm coming. Piglet, Piglet, Piglet. Oh, I can't get there.
I got him. Wait, maybe?
Lemon's a little too tanky to take down.
In.
This fight went for Cloud9. Last time they went to the base, Piglet dies immediately. 12-8, 38 minutes in. Cloud9 stays alive, and we got a game 4.